Today on the Business Roadshow, Asian markets fall after all three major U.S. indices lost ground overnight. Philippine inflation cools to its lowest level in more than a year. President Marcos again urged to intervene in the growing rift in between the houses of Congress over the latest push to amend the Constitution. Plus, later on the show, we check on the status of fish production in Dagupan City, which has been touted as the Bangus capital of the Philippines. Join us in the next hour as we bring you the latest in the financial world. I'm Stanley Palisada. Let's get this show on the road. Before anything else, let's check on the financial markets close to home. Regional equities trading lower following a negative lead from Wall Street overnight. All three major U.S. indices closed Monday's lower. Concerns, of course, are the U.S. Fed, which may not cut rates as much as expected. Taking a look now at major stock indices in Asia, Chinese markets are up after Chinese regulators vowed to, quote, guide institutional investors to enter the market with greater efforts following a recent sell-off. In the land down under, the ASX 200 closes in the red as investors examine Australia's latest monetary policy decision. Canberra's central bank held rates steady on Tuesday as expected, but it cautioned a further increase could not be ruled out given inflation was still too high. Taking a look now at futures in Europe, they are pointing to a rebound after a lackluster trade on Monday, still dominated by rate cut discussions. Now investors in the region will be on watch for construction and retail sales, which are coming out of the Eurozone. Stateside now, futures are flat with the focus on several central bank officials that slated to speak today. The Philippines' first inflation print for 2024 is the lowest level in over a year. The National Statistics Agency reports the Consumer Price Index for January came in at 2.8%. Now, that figure is the lowest since October 2022 and within the central bank's forecast for the month. It also fell within government's full-year target for 2024. Meanwhile, core inflation, which excludes items frequently subject to volatile prices in the CPI's basket of goods, also eased in January. The government points to slower increases in prices of food and non-alcoholic beverages, as well as housing and power costs for the decline. Despite this, the Philippine Central Bank deems it necessary to keep monetary settings sufficiently tight as it assesses the impact of the El Niño phenomenon on prices, a move that is already expected by financial analysts.
It is well within the expectations. We do expect, however, that given some potential risks in the second quarter with El Niño drought potentially causing an uptick in food prices, that might cause some upward pressure in the inflation numbers seasonally for the second quarter. So while this is good and this is within the general range of the BSP target range of 2 to 4%. We also expect that the central bank will likely hold on to the rates for as of the moment, and any rate cut will likely happen towards the second half of 2024.
As inflation eases, the Philippine government reaffirms its commitment to ensure prices of commodities remain affordable. The National Economic and Development Authority says it will closely monitor the cost of rice and other goods. It also vows to continue imposing stopgap measures, including importing key commodities to cushion the effects of El Niño. The Philippine government is confident rice harvest will be stable this year despite the threat of the El Niño phenomenon. Jervis Manahan tells us why.
Agricultural damage from El Niño has breached 100 million pesos, according to the latest bulletin of the Department of Agriculture. But the agency is confident that there will still be stable rice harvest despite the threats of the weather phenomenon.
Kung ihimayin natin yung datos, yung total damage doon, maliit lang, little over 100 hectares na naapektuhan talaga ng El Niño. Yung naapektuhan kasi ng El Niño talaga nauna yung western side. So, posible na nalilate pa lang yung report ng Luzon area.
Officials went around some rice fields in central Luzon and observed good standing crops, especially in Nueva Ecija, one of the country's largest rice granaries.
Nung binisita namin last week yung Nueva Ecija, yung ibang portions dyan sa may pabalik, maganda yung tayo ng mga palo. Maganda yung, ano, yung, kumbaga wala ako nakita kahit isang area na natuyuan at hindi nakatanim. So, meron pa nga ng mga late planters eh. So, ibig sabihin, meron ng iba-ibang level na meron malapit na mag-harvest, siguro by March, pwede na yun, in the next 2 to 3 months. Meron naman na kakalipat tanim. So, ibig sabihin, hindi nag-worry yung mga farmers natin.
In Pulilan, Bulacan, farmers still took their chances in planting rice. They were motivated by the good price of palay or unhusked rice last planting season and the promise of enough water supply.
Pinabi naman may patutubig kaya naglagay din kami. Mayroon kasi yung maghintay ka na, naglagay kami asahan ka.
The National Irrigation Administration said it will be building more irrigation facilities.
Talagang nag-increase po yung ating budget. Seryoso po ang ating Pangulo dito po sa ating pagtatayo ng mga bagong irrigation facilities. At the rate we're going, kayang-kaya po natin. Yung aming cropping calendar ngayon ay tinatama namin para ang NIA, yung aming mga irrigated land, ay makapagdalawang cropping man lamang kami sa panahon ng dry season.
NIA Chief Eduardo Guillen said he is hopeful rice self-sufficiency will be achieved by 2028. Ang Gat Dam level is at 210.33 meters as of Monday, slightly lower than the normal high level. The Department of Agriculture gave the assurance that there will be enough water to irrigate farmlands. Jervis Manahan, ABS-CBN News.
Denise Insay now joins us on the program to provide the latest on the ongoing push to amend the Constitution. Hi, Denise.
Hi, Stanley. Now, two former Senate presidents urging President Marcos to end the worsening rift between the two houses of Congress over charter change. Franklin De Leon says someone outside of Congress should mediate between the Senate and the lower house. De Leon adds the conflict does not serve public interest. Tito Soto also believes only President Marcos can end the rift. De Leon and Soto now calling on both chambers of Congress to hold a dialogue to thresh out their issues. On Monday, the House of Representatives issued a resolution condemning what it calls the Senate's attacks on House Speaker Martin Romualdez and the People's Initiative for Charter Change. Some corporate stories today. Panasonic Manufacturing resumes operations at its facility in Santa Rosa in Laguna. This came 2 months after it halted the production of electric fans in the factory due to a fire. It's also resuming the sale of these fans and the production of its washing machine units by March. Meanwhile, coconut products exporter Axelum lays out initiatives for long-term growth. The firm says it will maximize distributorship's third-party brands to expand global reach. Axelum will also reintroduce existing products and
billion pesos. Now to help us digest today's inflation numbers and how it is affecting sentiment in a good way is Jerry Alfonso of Regina Capital Development Corporation. She's also here to tell us possible directions for our rallying stock market. Hello, Jerry.
Hi, Stan. Good afternoon. Nice to be back.
It's good to have you back. Now, January inflation at 2.8, low, but not enough to prod BSP, of course, for an early rate cut. But this reading, though, is good enough to improve sentiment. How are you processing the new numbers for our market?
We perceive the decline in January inflation rate positively, and this adds to the light of optimism, how the equities market would play out this year. With the lower inflation rate, this indicates reduced pressure on the consumer purchasing power, and this could potentially lead to increased consumer spending, which then affects corporate profitability. Right now, there is a sense of relief as we see more stable economic environment, and the better than expected inflation rate, as well as the better than expected fourth quarter GDP last week, really boost investors' confidence. And the latest inflation reading cemented the idea that the BSP is done being hawkish.
Okay, now Jerry, the food basket as well as energy and even maybe a bit of transportation costs remain the upside risks to inflation. Now, which of these are most likely to have an effect in the coming months, especially if you are to factor in you have El Nino, you have supply chain disruptions from the ongoing wars?
We've been seeing a large increase in the price of rice, which has risen over 20% year on year due to the increases in the global market. However, it's a good thing that other commodities have been on the decline, so the impact on inflation should be less. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, with the oil prices, it is not as volatile as before, and we shouldn't see any sudden jumps in the local prices.
All right, all good. Now, are risk assets now likely to do better in an environment of easing inflation? Because, you know, inflation was one of the factors often blamed when the market did not do very well last year.
Mm-hmm. Risk assets typically perform better in environments of easing inflation, as it implies lower borrowing costs and improved consumer purchasing power. Last year's market underperformance was influenced by inflation concerns, among other factors. That's why a moderation in inflationary pressures could bolster in investors' confidence in riskier assets.
Okay, let's talk about Moody's now. Moody's, in its latest recent release, seeing household spending in the first half of 2024 to remain subdued. Now, how may this impact corporate earnings, since for the most part, in the last quarter of 2023, it were the household spending and even investments doing most of the heavy lifting. Jerry?
I'm sorry. Hello?
Yes, Jerry. Are you there?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, as I was saying, Moody's released a recent study. It was attributing the first half of the year to be subdued because household spending may not be as robust as before, and this can impact corporate earnings and revenues in the next 6 to 8 months. Mm-hmm. Now, for the large part of 2023, household spending and investment did most of the heavy lifting, with that perceived to be a bit weaker in 2024. How do you see this panning out?
I think inflation rate is already declining, so the household spending should increase in 2024.
All right. Now talk to us about the market today at these levels. Many issues are already oversold. Are you seeing that sign?
Yeah, there are a lot of oversold stocks right now. Actually, there are high flyer stocks, which are CNPF, GTCAP, and Monde. Yeah, and we deem these stocks to be overstretched already. However, we still see some potential flyers in the days ahead. And to name a few, we continue to like Semirara, SM Prime, and Blue. We are particularly interested in Semirara due to its anticipated dividend play, while SM Prime is appealing because of the positive outlook for the property sector, especially in light of the narrative surrounding the rate cuts, and also they recently announced that they are aiming for around 20 billion more capex this year. So we are expecting some pretty aggressive launches from them this year. And right now, we see three things that could propel the market upwards. First, we are anticipating a boost of inflows coming in the emerging markets as foreign investors get out of Chinese stocks. Second, right now, we are entering the earnings season, and the 2023 financial performances of the company could be a driver of the momentum of the stocks. And of course, lastly, the anticipated rate cuts from the Fed and the BSE. So I know the stocks are probably, it may seem that it's already overbought, it's already overstretched, but we still see a positive outlook in the PSE for this year.
Okay, relative to that, let's talk about participation. Our recent rally at the PSEI, though, breaking resistance It remains a bit unconvincing in that volumes still remain low. Now, in the past year, the new normal for stock market trading participation was, what, between 3 to 5 billion per day. Now, Jerry, what kind of turnover numbers do we need to hit to say that the rally is well matched with volume?
In our house, I think we should see at least a sustained 4 to 8 billion average daily turnover. That's a good start in terms of volume. But then again, as I've mentioned, we really see a positive outlook in the PSE for this year. We still inflows. We see inflows to increase this year.
All right. It was great talking to you again, Jerry Alfonso of Regina Capital. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Stan. Have a great day.
All right. Time for a quick break. When we come back, we'll talk to a delivery and errand service that operates in rural areas in the Philippines. Stay with ANC.
Welcome back. China firing back after the Philippines pinned the blame for recent cyber attack attempts on government websites on Chinese hackers. The Chinese embassy in Manila calls the remarks of some Philippine officials highly irresponsible. It says connecting the recent hacking attempts to maritime issues are malicious speculations. The embassy adds cybersecurity is a global challenge that requires a collective response from the international community. Meanwhile, Philippine Senator Risa Ontiveros calls for an investigation into the recent major cyber attack attempts on government websites. The Information and Communications Technology Department has confirmed cyber criminals targeted websites of the Philippine Coast Guard, Justice Department, the House of Representatives, as well as President Marcos's personal website. But it clarified there's no concrete evidence linking the Chinese government to the hacking attempts. Ontiveros has filed a resolution seeking an inquiry into the matter. The senator says instead of focusing on charter change that will only benefit some people, Congress should focus on strengthening laws to ensure national security. On a business roadshow today, we're featuring a delivery and errand service that specifically services rural areas in the country where mobility remains an issue. It's called Taxical, and its founder, Ray Leonard Dumasig, joins us now to tell us more about their business model. Ray, good to have you on the Business Roadshow. Ray?
Hi. Hello. Hi. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Perfect. Good afternoon, Ray. Now, e-commerce in the Philippines, the growth projection of this is estimated to reach $24 billion by 2025. And the e-commerce share of the Philippines right now in total retail is 5%. But here you are targeting the rural areas. I mean, what are some of the hindrances in the growth of e-commerce in those areas?
All right, just at the start, 52% of population in the Philippines actually live in rural areas, and up to 75% of SMEs are operating in rural areas. Now, the challenges are actually, digitalization of those SMEs and also a limited financial structure for farmers, fisher folks in which they can have access to probably loan on how they can operate or extend their runway on operating their business, and also some supply chain inefficiencies, which we can see that there's a lot of middlemen who actually get a lot of marks up, especially in selling to consumers. Those are actually the challenges that we're having in rural areas right now.
And how does your platform, Taxical, directly benefit rural entrepreneurs and producers?
So with Taxical, we help farmers to directly transact with consumers. So removing the intermediate, the middlemen, and making them, giving them a higher profit compared to what they're getting at the moment. Also, we're helping SMEs to actually put their product online without a cost on their end, and we're helping them on the marketing side.
And how do you address issues like limited internet access? I mean, internet access is already a main concern in general for the Philippines. How much more, in the rural areas?
You know what? Here in the rural areas, it's still, cash is king. And sometimes people tend to still use phone and social media and communicating. So one of our go-to-market strategies is actually focusing on social media like Facebook and Instagram. So some of our majority of our customers are actually more in placing their orders on our Facebook channel versus our website, because of how people like Facebook, and sometimes, and a lot of telco right now are offering free Facebook. So that's how we address connection issues here.
And how about when it comes to digital literacy and also trust concerns in rural populations? I mean, when it comes to digital literacy, not everyone is still quite comfortable with using e-commerce platforms there.
Yeah, that's correct. And that's why our strategy right now is really talking to them in a conversational manner via their social media, because these people are afraid to actually register on a new website, put up their email, probably their card, debit card information. So it's they're more confident and trustful when they're speaking to a real person. So for example, in our platform, we have different channels that they can speak to, probably by text, by call, by social media, Instagram, so that they know that they're speaking to a real people. On our end, how we do the KYC is we ask them to submit a valid ID, and and then we call them on the phone just to make sure that they're a real person and not a scammer.
I mean, now that you mentioned it, to make sure that people aren't a scammer, the cash on delivery reliance, how are you also, ensuring that you guys are protected, the producers and the farmers are protected, the customers are protected? How do you make sure that across all platforms, all the stakeholders, are safe?
So when we do our KYC, and it's a huge volume or a large transaction, we require the buyer to actually put up a down payment, like a 50% of the cost, so that making sure that we have it. Taxical on our end, we ensure the producer that we will, we purchase everything and we'll cover the cost. And then when we deliver, we get the necessary fee that we need to get to the buyer.
And right now, Ray, which rural areas in the Philippines do you service?
Right now, we're focusing in Lingayen and the nearby areas here in Pangasinan. So that's Binmali, Bugalyon, Labrador, which is a very, in the rural area side of the Philippines. And we're planning to expand to other rural areas as well. One of the plans this year is actually to expand to different rural areas in Pangasinan, probably in Ilocos Norte as well.
And what's next for the app? I mean, what innovative features or strategies, do you use your platform to engage with rural communities? And as all e-commerce platform wants, of course, increase user adoption.
So right now on our product roadmap is we are actually implementing, we have a proprietary route optimization algorithm we're using AI to actually optimize the delivery, making sure that we're efficient in terms of the speed of delivery. We plan to use the generative AI as well in talking to customers, making sure that they're very well assisted real time. So those are in the product roadmap.
And how do you leverage, of course, the social commerce aspects to foster trust and also, that community within your platform?
The good thing about, using or being a social commerce is that you can build really a community inside a social platform, like for example in Facebook. So in Facebook, we have a Taxical community, and all of our partner merchants are actually there and consumers are actually also there. So they're like posting everything, having an interaction. If we're looking for something like this, a consumer will just post there and then one of our merchants will actually just, you know, oh, we have this and we can deliver it via TaxiCode. So those kind of things. It's really building something within the community, making sure that, the community works closely with each other and as TaxiCode. It, you know, we're using the mode of transportation as well, in which it's very close to their heart, which is using bicycles and motorcycles.
I mean, it is very Filipino. But looking ahead and looking at the industry outlook for 2024, do you see the same trends or emerging technologies shaping the future of rural e-commerce the same way it also is the same in urban areas?
There's a huge opportunity because right now, as you can see, COVID made a lot, a huge difference. People from urban areas starting to relocate to rural areas because working at home is already a norm already. And people back then didn't realize that, it's possible to actually work, go back to your province and then work. So there's actually a lot of opportunity. A lot of people are relocating in the province already. Based from the market study as well, that there's by this year, we're actually looking at a growth of like a 13.78 annual growth on the e-commerce side. And come to think of it, as I've said, up to 75% of our SMEs are actually operating in rural areas. And population-wise in the Philippines, up to 52% are living in rural areas.
Ray Leonard Dumasig, founder of TaxiCode. Ray, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you as well. Nice to meet you.
Now, we're stepping aside for a quick break now, but stick around because when we return, we'll check on the local milkfish industry amid the dry spell affecting the country. Stay with us.
Welcome back to the show. The Philippine Transportation Department sets aside 14 billion pesos for the development and modernization of some 20 airports across the country. These include airports in Catbalogan, Tacloban, Lawag, Puerto Princesa, Calibo, and Iloilo. Now, the DOTR says several other airports are being developed also under the Marcos administration's public-private partnership scheme. Meanwhile, the agency is seeking funding for its long-delayed Mindanao Railway project after China withdrew its financial commitment. The DOTR is already in talks with the Finance Department to look for funds from other foreign governments and international financial institutions. The proposed railway system aims to connect key provinces down south and further enhance Mindanao's economy. And speaking of travel, a global index on passport openness ranks the Philippine travel document at 17th place this year. Manila stood at the said spot out of 199 countries. In the 2024 edition of the report by Henley and Partners, now this measures the number of nationalities that countries and territories permit to entry to without a prior visa. Now, the Philippines previously placed 73rd in the Henley Index, measuring the world's most powerful passports. A new mobile remittance application eyeing growth in micro-remittances to offer OFWs more control over the funds they send to their families. More from Jackie Pascual.
Mobile remittance app Tanggap is eyeing growth in micro-remittances or small amounts sent from the U.S. to the Philippines. Its founder and CEO Rebecca Kirsch says 90% of the transactions in the app are $500 and less. This trend will continue, she asserts, as overseas Filipinos now prefer to send smaller amounts for specific purposes than a huge amount for general reasons.
Customers used to send $1,000 a month. Now they send anything from $20 to $200 three to four times a week. So they're not necessarily sending less money, they just have more control of the funds.
The smaller amounts can be specifically for medical expenses or a birthday gift, as the minimum amount that can be sent is $5. This also goes straight to an e-wallet platform in the Philippines or any bank account. Kirsch adds they offer no transfer fee, just a minimum charge on the foreign exchange.
It's 3% that we add on the exchange rate. We don't add a transfer fee. There's no additional commission on sending money. Sending money should be as easy as texting, regardless of where you live, what you earn, or how much you want to send.
Tanggap has also launched its outbound remittances, which they say is the fastest growing segment in the remittance industry. Times are changing and Filipinos now are sending money to the U.S. too, for many reasons, like for their kids who are studying abroad or if they ask a friend to buy something for them in the U.S.
A lot of family members who just want to thank a lot of their family members in the U.S. Who have helped support them. There's also the use case for kids who are studying abroad, for parents to send them money, and even like Filipinos who want to invest money in the U.S.
Puno adds that soon they want to bring the app to the Middle East where there is a huge population of Filipinos. New features may also be added, like linking the app to utility companies for bills payments. Tanggap has raised a total funds of $4 million from foreign and local angel investors. It will open its pre-Series A round of funding soon. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
World news, Britain's King Charles III has been diagnosed with cancer. Buckingham Palace said the 75-year-old monarch will step back from public engagements as he undergoes treatment. The palace did not specify what form of cancer was detected. But the update came a month after King Charles underwent corrective procedure for an enlarged prostate. Charles became king in September 2022 following the death of his mother, Queen Elizabeth II. Prince Harry is reportedly returning to London to see the king following the cancer diagnosis. Reuters royal correspondent said Harry will travel to the UK in the coming days in what could be the first sign of reconciliation within the royal family. Prior to the health issue, the biggest shadow over the royals was the fallout between Harry and his family. The Duke of Sussex had returned to Britain on a few occasions since he and his wife, Meghan Markle, moved to California in 2020. World leaders sending their well wishes to King Charles after his cancer diagnosis. On ex British Prime Minister Rishi Sunak wrote, he has no doubt the monarch will be back to full strength in no time. The British Parliament also hoping for the king's successful treatment.
I know the whole House will wish to join me in expressing our sympathies with His Majesty the King following the news announcement this evening. Our thoughts are, of course, with His Majesty and his family, and with all wish to send him our very best wishes for the successful treatment and a speedy recovery.
Meanwhile, U.S. President Joe Biden said he joins the people of the U.K. in praying for the king's swift and full recovery. He added navigating a cancer diagnosis takes hope and absolute courage. Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau also hoping for the king's fast and full recovery. Australia's Prime Minister looking forward to the return of King Charles to his public duties.
The thoughts of all Australians are with King Charles and his family. We wish him very much a speedy recovery. I will be sending a message to the palace this morning, and we hope that King Charles has a speedy recovery and a return to his duties as soon as possible.
The British public shocked and saddened to hear about the king's condition. They are sending heartfelt thoughts to the monarch. Some hope the royal family would rally around him, while others encourage the king to rest and let his son William take over his duties.
Feels like something a family would want to go through in private anyway, but having been a person in the public eye for so long, I'm sure he is aware of how how much that will connect him to other people, other families who would go through that. It's a bit of a shock. Like, I'm genuinely...
He's got to have the best doctors. He's got the best chance. Age against him. Rest up, boy. And abdicate. Give up the throne. Give it to William. You get better.
Elsewhere in the world, catastrophic flooding swamps Los Angeles as a deadly storm pummels Southern California. At least two were killed by toppled trees in the coastal Santa Cruz Mountains. A state of emergency has been declared in eight counties with a combined population of over 2 million people. More than half a million homes and businesses also without power. The severe storm system began moving through the state on Friday, delivering a deluge of rain up and down the coast. Over in Chile, the death toll from raging wildfires in the country climbs to 122. This number is expected to rise further as authorities race to clear rubble in fire-hit residential areas. Hundreds of people still missing and some 14,000 homes have been damaged. Chile and other parts of South America's southern cone had been facing a severe heat wave, exacerbated by the El Niño phenomenon. Authorities are bracing for the worst, with hundreds of fires still active in the country. A Filipino-American pop-up museum in Chicago offers a glimpse into the Filipino community's history in the U.S. Take a look.
Images of the past look back at us. In Chicago, this Filipino-American pop-up museum is a gentle reminder of how important it is to remember our rich history, especially in the U.S.
Our past isn't perfect. There are a lot of horrible things that happened to us as a people as we were being colonized. But there's a lot to celebrate and find beautiful in that history as well.
When the U.S. colonized the Philippines in the late 1800s, the Ifugao people were paraded in places like Chicago and were depicted as savages. Museums curated and collected by PhilAMS now give the community a chance to learn about our stories beyond the lens of the past.
The community just like takes responsibility for its own preservation and history.
That's Ashley Dequila, who has taken up the mantle to help preserve Filipino Chicago history in partnership with organizations like FONS or the Filipino American National Historical Society. All of the artifacts here are from the collection of beloved historian Tita Estrella Alomar, who died a few years ago.
It's long overdue, absolutely. Even my friends who are not Filipino have an increased fascination and interest in it. It's really shocking that we don't have a dedicated museum yet, so it's definitely time.
Even artist Willie Red Buhay showcased one of his many paintings.
The early Filipinos in St. Malo, one of the livelihoods they had was making dried shrimps.
Alomar co-wrote the book Filipinos in Chicago and dedicated her entire life to collecting and preserving images, films, knickknacks, and even a cow, all from the Windy City. She did eventually fulfill her dream of opening up a museum decades ago, but it didn't last long.
The reason why the museum was closed down is because of lack of funding.
Chicago Fans President Ruben Salazar is looking to kickstart fundraising effort to preserve house and eventually open a museum. The artifacts here are displayed temporarily, and the organization is looking for volunteers to help preserve and keep the spirit alive.
As Rizal had said, it is important that you know your past. You cannot go into the future without looking back at your past.
What makes Alomar's collection unique is they capture everyday PhilAMS in Chicago.
When Filipinos and other diasporic communities look at the foundation that she started, they're going to take more pride in their own histories, in their own family archives, in their own community archives.
Alomar's collection is vast, requiring a lot of research and additional funding to help archive the materials. Reporting for TFC News, Kat Sandoval, ABS-CBN News in Chicago, Illinois.
Our next guest today is the mayor of Dagupan City, which is known as the milkfish or bangus capital of the Philippines. Now, as the country feels the effects of the El Nino phenomenon, how is Dagupan preparing for the weather event? Let's ask Dagupan City Mayor Belen Fernandez. Good afternoon, Mayor Fernandez. Welcome to the Business Roadshow.
Good afternoon.
All right, it's good to have you here, Mayor. Now, to quote the Bureau of Fisheries and Aquatic Resources, it has been saying that El Nino is, of course, good for deep sea fish like tuna, but bad for bangus. Now, what is the situation in the fish ponds in Dagupan City there right now as we are really feeling the effects of the dry spell?
Well, as of now, Dagupan City have about 910 hectares operational of fish pond, but there are about 179 hectares that are already non-operational.
Not operational because of the dry spell?
No, it's not operational because some has been converted into commercial area.
Okay, converted.
And as of now, we don't have any problem on our fish pond. It's not dry and nobody's still complaining. It's still okay. We are still producing bangus regularly.
All right. Now, El Nino is not yet over. And of course, in the next couple of months, it will be critical, according to the Weather Bureau. What interventions will the local government undertake in case that, you know, El Nino affects the fish ponds in your area?
Yes, you're right. In fact, the bangus industry is one of our priority in our city. You know that our milkfish is very famous for that. But first, I have to organize the fish pond owners and make sure to understand if there are any problems, if there are any parasitic diseases or predator that is affecting their fish pond. And of course, we know that the Dagupan City always have, every time you always have a high tide situation.
Okay.
And that this is only the chance that to refresh our fish pond. So we have to make sure that our fish pond owners or the caretakers are alert in taking care of them, making sure that their floodgates are open during the high tide situation. And of course, we know that the Dagupan City, they've said that, well, this is a very low-lying area. And well, in fact, the water comes from the higher up places and down to the city of Dagupan. And that's why, if you notice, one of our island barangays is the mouth of the river.
Yeah.
So I think our fish pond owners have to make sure if the drought will continue or the El Nino, everybody have to make or have to pump out water or fresh water to make sure that the water in the fish pond will be protected. So they should engage in making their own deep well, and the city government should help them by providing the water pumps.
Okay.
And that's very critical.
Okay, Mayor Fernandez, is there any indication that, you know, a lot of these producers are cutting back or slowing down on production or even investing in bangus production in the next couple of months because of El Nino? Are they apprehensive? What are they telling you?
Well, I think the problem now is not about, they're not cutting down their production of bangus, not because of the drought or the, I would say, the El Nino. But the problem is that the cost of the feeds for the bangus is keep on going up. And I think sometimes it is becoming unprofitable for them.
Okay.
But it's not caused by the El Nino.
All right. Now, how is the collaboration now between the Bureau of Fisheries and Aquatic Resources, which has the expertise, and the local government in terms of predicting, you know, the next couple of months, what the scenario will be for the bangus industry?
Well, what the city is doing right now, aside from the Bureau of Fisheries, we continue to coordinate with the Department of Public Works because there are ongoing dredging of our river, which is very, very important. I think for now, the DPWH should double time their dredge of the river, and we continue to stop illegal fish pen or fish cages in our river to make sure that the flow of the river is very clear and the navigation is open. And with the BIFAR, we have been dealing with them. They're not only helping us with this possibility of effects of El Nino in the Dagupan City, but we're also working on them on how to save our river from any parasites or anything. So right now we are working with the BIFAR, not only for the El Nino, but we're also investing, helping our fishermen to put on more oyster farm to make sure that our river are clean.
Okay. Yeah, Mayor Fernandez, you know, a lot of people don't realize this, but bangus is an important commodity for a lot of consumers in the Philippines, it being very accessible and, of course, not as expensive as other fish. And, you know, the impact of some cutback in production could be immense in terms of inflationary pressures because of perceived shortages that will result in price increases. Now, are there alternative products also from dagupan in the aquaculture industry that could replace the bangus should it become rare or even too risky for a lot of fish ponds to invest through the El Nino months?
Well, I think because in the city of Dagupan, we have the brackish water. Yeah. So it cannot just put any kind of species in our fish pond or in our cages. We have some farmers doing on lapu-lapu, our talakitok, fishes, but it's only a small percentage of fishermen that are doing that.
Okay.
And I think the effect of the El Nino, if it would really affect our fisher folks, then the volume of bangus will be going down. But I think the concern here really is more on the prices.
Right,
as of now, despite that there is no El Nino, our fisher farm owners were affected by the so much low price, the selling price of bangus in our city, despite that we have the best bangus. Imagine the price of bangus now is only 145 pesos, the two-in-one size.
That's per kilo,
but,
right?
During the peak season, it would reach up to 180 pesos. So as of now, I think the prices really concerned of affecting our fishermen is more on the prices or the income of our fisher folks.
All right. On that note, we thank you so much for joining us, Dagupan City Mayor Belen Fernandez. Thank you so much for the insights today, for the conversation. We wish you well.
Thank you very much.
Moving on for numbers that matter today, it's 73 billion pesos. This was the Customs Bureau's revenue collection in the first month of 2024, which was higher by 1.5 billion. That's its target of 71.7 billion. It's also an improvement by nearly 4% from its collection in the same period last year. The agency says the better system of determining customs value of imported goods, as well as tighter border collection, among others, had helped push collections up. Customs officials are upbeat on maintaining the higher collections this year. The agency says this will help contribute to the economy and will show its commitment to fiscal responsibility.
And before we go, Hello Kitty has turned golden. And to celebrate the 50th anniversary of Japan's famous fictional cat, London Somerset House has dedicated an exhibition to Hello Kitty and all things kawaii. In partnership with Japanese entertainment company Sanrio, the exhibit features a dedicated Hello Kitty plushie space, an immersive disco displaying Hello Kitty products, and memorabilia throughout the decades. The exhibit will run until April 14. And those are the latest in all things business. I'm Denise Binsai. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online.
And I'm Stanley Palisada. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel. Like us on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter. And join us again tomorrow for another edition of the Business Roadshow.